This weekend, we've had our Jumpstart Your Marriage conference. This was the second year in a row to do this. And 1,000 people, I'm told, were part of this conference Friday night and on Saturday. And we've just been thrilled to see what God is up to in the lives of the marriages of this church family. Today, we have the joy of having the speaker that was here for Jumpstart be our speaker this morning, and his name is Gary Thomas. Most of you are probably familiar with Gary. He has written 21 books. I think he's been busy. The most recent is Cherish, and then just a year ago, I think, or two, was A Lifelong Love. What if marriage is more about than just staying together? I encourage you to get these books if you can. And so it's a privilege for me to introduce him to you, to Edmund, to our venue. We have just a special joy today to hear from this good man who is a humble, wonderful, godly man who has inspired a whole lot of people in his journey. He unites, this is something I enjoyed from a description of him. He unites the study of Scripture to bolster spiritual growth and deeper relationships. And he does that with only a gift that God could have given him. He's married to Lisa. They have 3 children. They reside in Houston, Texas, where he's also on staff at Second Baptist Church there in Houston. Would you please give a warm Crossings welcome to Gary Thomas?
Thank you. You all are part of a blessed body. You've blessed me so much this morning with your worship and praise. Back when my wife and I were a much younger couple, we had just one toddler child, little girl. We lived in a small rundown house. We rented a little tiny house. It had a shared driveway with another very small house, and that was occupied by a single gal who lived there with her cat named Remington. Remington sort of claimed the whole property, and I've never been much of a cat person. I love dogs. I think dogs are one of God's greatest creatures. Not so fond of cats. And I think that's a little objective, because if somebody tells me they have a dozen dogs, my first thought is, oh, you have a kennel. And if somebody tells me you have a dozen cats, my first thought is, oh, you have a mental illness. So I'm teasing if you're a cat person. That's just dog lover humor. But having been a dog person my entire life, I never thought that one of my first real tests as a husband would be having a sincere funeral for a cat. But that's what actually happened one morning as I'm coming out of the shared driveway, and right in front of the driveway in the street, I saw Remington, a car, a truck, something had hit him overnight. I thought, man, I can't just leave him here. So I parked my car, went to our neighbor as gently as I could, tried to explain what I had found. She came running out, and she saw Remington. She just starts crying on the spot. Well, that drew my wife and daughter's attention, so they came running out. They saw Remington, and they're crying. So now I'm practically crying, not between you and me. I care that much about one less cat in the world, but really trying to be a sensitive father and husband and friend to our neighbor. They finally decided we needed to send Remington off properly with a funeral, and since I was going to seminary at the time, I was chosen to lead the service. My first funeral was literally for a cat. It gets worse than that. It was actually good training in that I found you have to be careful. People like to speak well of the dead. And so when somebody said Remington seemed like an unusually smart cat, I just held my tongue because I thought, he's a cat. He got hit by a car. How smart could he be? But I said, you don't do that. I let that go. And then finally, we got him in the ground, and I thought with some degree of sensitivity, I could get back to my day. So I walked toward my car. My wife and daughter went into our house. Our neighbor peeled off into hers. And just as I touched the door handle of my car, thinking, here's freedom, I heard a piercing scream coming from my neighbor's house. I ran up her steps, and she's standing right in the front of the door, white-faced, ashen. She can't even speak. She just turns and points toward the couch, and there sat Remington waving his tail. We'd buried somebody else's cat. To this day, we don't know whose cat we buried. But my first funeral was a complete farce, right? I mean, the second lesson, make sure you're burying the right person. And I just... But if you had told me as a high school student, a college student, even earlier on, just young, married, that part of being a faithful and loving husband would be having a funeral for a cat and keeping a straight face, I don't know that I could have imagined that. And now 32 years into my marriage, I don't really believe marriage is so often about the how-tos. I think how-tos can be very helpful, don't get me wrong. There are certain skills that we would do well to learn. But for me, what has impacted my marriage the most is really holding on to three spiritual truths. When I have this new understanding of the way I look at marriage, it has transformed the way I act in marriage, and I believe greatly increased my satisfaction in marriage. I want to share those three spiritual attitudes with you today. And singles, I don't want you to worry. There is a lot in here for you. I want you to get this even before you get married, as I think it'll have a huge impact on who you decide to marry, or at least I hope it would. The first spiritual attitude that really changed the way I looked at my marriage is what I call the magnificent obsession. Embracing the magnificent obsession. Now, before I explain what it is, let me set up the need for it. As one who's been in marriage ministry for a couple decades, I'm always looking out at the polls and the statistics of why people break up. And frankly, I'm not sure they're asking the right questions. Because it can be finances, it can be in-laws, certainly those have an impact. But most of the couples that come into my pastor's office, when I see they're having issues, you know the honest truth? They're just bored with each other. They just are. And part of that goes back to basic human nature. When you think about it, none of us are so fascinating that we can keep somebody enthralled for 50 or 60 years. We're just not. 5 or 6 dates, no problem. 5 or 6 years, that's a challenge, 50 or 60. Look, even if you're Jerry Seinfeld or Tina Fey, after a while, your spouse knows all your punchlines, right? They know every one of your opinions, all of your theological stances. There's just not that much to keep us fascinated with each other. But buried within that reality is the hope for a renewed marriage, because what it tells me is that we were made for more than each other. God made us for more than each other. He even made us for more than marriage. It might seem a little bizarre at the start of a sermon on marriage. I'm saying that the way we renew our marriage is to look outside our marriage. But Jesus gave us what I believe is the true definition of a fulfilling life in the heart of the Sermon on the Mount. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, he says this: seek first not an intimate marriage, not successful children, not even a fulfilling vocation. His words are, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And then there's this promise and all these other things that everybody else worries about. Those will be added in as well. But keep your focus on building my kingdom. And the reality is, God made us for more than each other. And if we settle for anything less than having an eternal impact as part of God's kingdom, there's going to be this listlessness in our souls. Once we were fascinated with this person, we get to know him, and suddenly we feel like there's got to be more to life than this. And if we're not spiritually aware, we'll blame our spouse. We'll blame our marriage rather than blaming our purpose. But what I'm here to say is that small lives can't sustain big marriages. God knows the power you can have when you're empowered by his Holy Spirit and led by the wisdom of his word in community of fellowship, encouraging each other. And he's not going to let you settle for less than that. He wants you to be who he created you to be. And so I tell young people, don't worry about falling out of love. Worry about falling out of purpose. Because it's the lack of purpose that makes our marriages lose meaning. And singles, that's why you want to marry a fellow believer, because it's really hard to have a marriage with two different purposes. When your ultimate purpose is to build God's kingdom and somebody else's purpose is to build their own, that's not a very good match. Now, the second half of this isn't just seeking first his kingdom, that we renew our marriages by finding out how do we double down? Why did God call us together? What is our role in his kingdom? The second part, he says, is and his righteousness. And this is so brilliant, because if I do what Jesus tells me to do, seek first, continually seek his righteousness, I'm going to die to the very things that make most marriages miserable. I'll die to impatience, unkindness, anger. All of those things that make two people so miserable living together, I will die to those. And then, because righteousness is also the Christ-like virtues, I'm going to grow in the things that build up my marriage. Patience, kindness, gentleness, and self-control. And so though Jesus isn't specifically referring to marriage in Matthew 6:33, if we take it seriously that I need more purpose and I need a more earnest pursuit of godliness, our marriages will be lifted up accordingly, because that's the magnificent obsession. Just give two quick examples. Lisa and I got married very young. We were practically kids. But I would say over the course of 3 decades, I've really seen Lisa grow and excel in kindness. God has made her such a kind woman. And when I got married at 22, I very likely was the most selfish husband alive. And God has worked on me, and I still have a lot of ways to go, but it has so changed. Now, just imagine how a marriage could be different if you're pouring in a lot of kindness on a daily basis. Imagine how a marriage changes if you're pouring in a lot of unselfishness and service instead of selfishness. Just imagine how that's going to improve a marriage. Now take all the virtues of Christ, gentleness and courage and patience and all those other things, and you see how two people pursuing righteousness are going to have a marriage that gets better and better and better if we just do what Jesus says. So while I tell couples also, don't worry about falling out of love, I also say, worry about falling out of purpose. I'll say, don't worry about falling out of love. Worry about falling out of repentance. Because these are the two things that help us grow. You see, and I want singles to get this. The whole challenge with infatuation, which is why so many singles get married, is that we know from neuroscience now, studying our brain, that it's about a 12 to 18 month experience. Unless you literally have a damaged brain, infatuation can't last longer than that. And actually, it can lead you astray. Neurologists warn that you enter a stage when you're infatuated called idealization, which means that you create somebody who literally doesn't exist. You give them strengths they don't really have. You miss the weaknesses that everybody else sees. Imagine an infatuated couple at a college campus. They finish their dinners. They're walking away with their trays, and the girlfriend's behind the boyfriend, and a napkin flies off his tray. He bends down and picks it up, and the girlfriend is so overwhelmed at this incredible act of piety and character, she wants to get him nominated for the Nobel Peace Prize. She runs in front. Did you see what he picked up the napkin? I mean, he cares about the waitstaff. Obviously, he's concerned about the environment. Next to Jesus Christ, I don't know if a man of his character has ever walked this earth. And the friends say, okay, fine. He picked up a napkin, but you know, he's got these weaknesses that we don't think you see. He seems kind of angry to us. No, he's just passionate. That's what I love about him so much. He's so passionate. I don't know. It seemed to me like he was cussing that guy out. Actually, I think he was just speaking in tongues. You know, he's got a very spirit. And so she... Infatuation blinds you and it can't sustain you. Find someone with whom you can seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness if you want a lifelong love that goes the distance. And if you're married and you need to renew your marriage, consider purpose, consider righteousness. That's what will lift up your marriage. The second attitude I found that was so helpful for me is that I had to grow in what my greatest need was. And when I got married, what I thought my greatest need was, I believe was 180 degrees differently than what God thought my greatest need was. I want to be beautiful before the Lord. I know you want to be beautiful before the Lord. And of course, we're only beautiful in the Lord because of the work of Jesus Christ. But there is a sense on how we dress ourselves spiritually. We think so much about how we present ourselves physically, what clothes we wear, some of you with makeup, some of you have to comb your hair. I really don't worry about windy days where I live now. But what makes us beautiful spiritually? A friend of mine is a young worship leader, and the challenge he has with a growing family is getting to church in time on Sunday. He can't be late. He starts off the service, and so usually he'll just take whatever kids are ready, and then his wife will follow along later with the ones that haven't gotten ready yet. One Sunday, it was just his little toddler daughter, and he's still running behind, so he puts her in the back of the minivan, and he's driving to church like this, trying to get there. He pulls up to the church, opens up the side door of the minivan, and his heart just sinks. His wife had left a tube of red lipstick in the back seat, and his toddler girl got, and she just painted her face, right? She looked like a clown. It was in her hair. He's like, oh, honey, we don't have time for this. Here, give Daddy the lipstick. She goes, but Daddy, I'm not beautiful yet. He said, honey, lipstick doesn't make you beautiful. It doesn't. No, you need mascara and blush. And he's from Dallas, what can I say? But she wanted to be beautiful as she went to church. What makes us beautiful before the world? And that's what this second attitude directly addresses. I thought my greatest need was to be loved. Because every movie I looked at growing up, the plot of just about every novel, the message of every pop song is you'll be fulfilled, you'll be happy, you'll have a great marriage when you find that one person who can love you like nobody ever has or ever will. You need to find that soulmate, and when you're loved, life takes on a whole new tone. But the day I got married, I believe God would have said to me, if I would have listened, Gary, your greatest need was to be loved until you met me. I sent my son to prove my love for you. And I've given you my Holy Spirit to empower you, to convict you, to counsel you, to encourage you, a word to direct me. You could not be loved more than you're loved now. Therefore, your greatest need isn't to be loved. Your greatest need is to learn how to love. Now, I have a thick skull. I have a hard heart. It took God a long time for me to understand the implications. I fought against this, but I'll tell you this. When I thought my greatest need every day was to be loved, and I didn't feel like my wife noticed me or appreciated or loved me like I thought I deserved, it led to bitterness, frustration, and anger. But when I became convinced in my head and in my heart that my greatest need was to learn how to love, every day about marriage changed. In fact, the things that I used to resent, I could now at least appreciate, even though I didn't always enjoy, because I realized every day of marriage, every day of parenting, every day of work gives us an opportunity to learn how to grow in love if we think that's a big need. Now, I don't expect you just to take my opinion. You shouldn't just take my opinion. But there are dozens of scriptures that urge us to grow in love. Let me give you just a few that talk about this. Colossians 3:14, the Apostle Paul writes this, "Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony." Paul's just listed all of these things that he wants the Colossians to do. He says, but you know what? Above all of this, you can kind of throw all that. What really matters is that you learn how to love. That's what it means to be a believer. And then Peter, an entirely different writer. If you're not familiar with the New Testament, the names of the books are the authors who wrote it. This is an entirely different writer. In 1 Peter 4:8, Peter says this, above all, same words, maintain constant love for one another, for love covers a multitude of sins. Now, if you know the persons of Peter and Paul, they were real people. They had very different backgrounds. Paul grew up as a scholastic rabbi. He got involved in the law. He was sort of the white-collar kind of guy. Peter was a tempestuous fisherman, the emotional blue-collar kind of guy. Totally different training, totally different temperament, totally different background. And then I read what they say really matters most in the Christian life, and both of them sound like they're saying the same thing. You know, and it's almost impossible for a teacher not to give their opinions and their view of life. And yet here are two people who obviously they're not speaking out of their own experience. There's something that has convinced them that what they say, what you really need more than anything is to learn how to love. And that's something. Something is that they learn to listen to the same teacher. Jesus changed everything about how we are to live, not just with the magnificent obsession, but his great call in John chapter 13. I don't know that any more powerful words have ever been uttered. These might be among the most powerful verses even in all of Scripture. Beginning with verse 34, Jesus says this, "A new commandment I give to you." He's going to be telling his disciples goodbye, but before he does, this isn't a suggestion. It's his way of saying, above all, that they would later mimic, a new commandment I give to you, and here's what it is, that you love one another even as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples if you have love one for another. So Jesus' plan, Cassius, this is so key, Jesus' plan to reach the world is to raise a community of believers who so excel in love, who are extravagant in their love, that when others watch them, they're going to recognize a commonality and say, what is up with you people? And we say, well, we've been so loved by God. We have so much love to give. And they say, how do I get a part of that? And that's how God spreads his word. Doesn't have a plan B. That's plan A. And if we apply this to marriage, what Jesus is saying is this. Somebody should be able to watch a Christian wife. They should be able to look at a Christian husband, not know anything about him, not even know their faith, not know their name, but just watching the way husband and wife treat each other, they should be able to come to this conclusion, oh, you know what? I bet you they're one of those believers. I bet you he's one of those Christians, because whenever I see a wife treat her husband that way or talk about her husband that way, whenever I see a husband that is that solicitous toward his wife and that caring and that cherishes his wife that way, they always end up being believers. I bet you they're one of those Christians. But most of us don't think the world looks at us that way, do they? And here's the hard question. Why not? This convicts me before it convicts you. Maybe it's because we haven't accepted Jesus' words that his commandment is that we learn how to love one another. Maybe we've accepted it as a suggestion for the super spiritual Christians. After all, we don't really have to do this to be saved, right, Jesus? So we'll go about our life. We're still going to find our soulmate. But this thing about really growing on how to love somebody, I don't really receive it as a command. It's not that important. And in fact, I believe that this point, this passage may be the focal point of spiritual warfare today, because here's what I see Satan doing and what he's done at least the last 50 years. Satan knows if we did this, he's toast. There isn't anything he can concoct. Lust, materialism, prejudice, malice, gossip, none of those compare to the fulfillment and joy that comes from love and obedience, from encouraging and serving and blessing and loving and cherishing. The things of God are so much better that if people could really see a contrast, he would have no appeal to the world. And Satan, realizing how perilous his plans are, has concocted this plan, I believe, where he says, look, we've got to go to the people who make movies. We've got to go to the people who write songs and who write novels and the poets and popular culture. We've got to say, you know what? Your greatest need isn't to learn how to love, because if everybody does that, we're gone. Your greatest need is to find somebody to love you. Because if they find out that there's something better than that, we're done. And so he's concocted this whole nation of a soulmate, and then we get infatuated. And for a while, it does make us feel like we've lost our mind, and it feels so wonderful until we wake up to the reality that without purpose, without repentance, infatuation falls away. And we spend our lives keep trying to find the new infatuation, the new romantic high, realizing that what we really need, what God really created us for, was to learn how to love. There are dozens of scriptures. Love extravagantly. Love even your enemies. Yet tell me one scripture, even one, where God says, for a fulfilling life, find a romantic partner who will love you. The weight of scripture speaks loudly. The silence of scripture speaks loudly. I believe if we'll accept that our greatest need is to learn how to love, our marriages will change. Because what we used to resent, now we can appreciate. If we really think that's our need. You see, if you don't understand this, you'll be like one of those people who drive to the gym and do circles around the gym looking for a close place to park before you go exercise. And you start to say, am I missing the big picture here? And then you go in and you're not cursing out the machines. Oh, I hate these machines. I mean, it makes my triceps hurt, and these curls, it makes my biceps hurt. And this treadmill and this step, it's so stupid. I sweat and I get sore and I'm tired. You don't think of it that way. In fact, you probably pay $75 a month to go to the gym to make yourself hurt, to make yourself sore, to make yourself tired. Why do you do that? Because you're thinking, I can be a different person. I can be stronger. I can be fitter. I can be healthier. I can be faster. What if you looked at the challenges of marriage, and instead of resenting how it makes you hurt, to die to your pride, to learn how to serve instead of be served, to learn how to forgive or ask for forgiveness? What if you say, if I do this, if marriage is my spiritual gym, I can be gentler. I can be more humble. I can be more patient. I can be more like Christ. If I look at my marriage that way, if I believe that my greatest need is to learn how to love. And then finally, the third one. First one, embrace the magnificent obsession. Second, understand that your greatest need is to learn how to love, not to be loved. But the third one that changed me even more than these two, I think it's been the transformational understanding for me in my marriage, was to embrace marriage as worship. God took one of the most powerful experiences I've ever had to change my view of marriage. And it came when my wife gave birth to our first child, our baby daughter. I was a pacifist up until that time. I'd written papers on it. I'd read a lot of books, looked at the scriptures. How could any Christian in any occupation, any situation, ever respond in a violent way? I was as convinced as a young, idealistic person could be. And it all fell apart on March 20th when my oldest daughter was born. I didn't read any new verses. I didn't read any new books. I'd read so many. I didn't hear any new sermons. All that happened is my baby girl was born. The nurse took that daughter, put her up on my wife's chest, and I looked at that little girl, and I said, anybody touches her, I'm doing prison ministry from the inside for the rest of my life. See, a whole new ministry focus for Gary. And it was God just blowing it up when I realized that there's some things we are really called to protect. Because it pulled things out of me I never knew before. And God used that later on then when I was not being a very good husband. And that's being kind to myself. And I was praying and God was convicting me saying, Gary, Lisa isn't just your wife. She's my daughter. And I expect you to treat her accordingly. And I realized what God was doing was applying 1 John 3:1 to my marriage. Behold, how great a love the Father has given us, lavished on us, that we would be called his children. And now he looks at my wife just the same way. I always claim that as a single man. I'm his son. That'll never change. All of that will happen. And now God says, that's true, Gary. You are my son, but that means your wife is my daughter. And out of reverence for me, I want you to love her. I want you to cherish her. Think of all you owe me. And now, it's no longer about loving my wife just because she's lovable. Not no longer loving my wife just because she deserves it, but because she is beloved by a heavenly Father to whom I owe so much. We believe that God is our heavenly Father. That's a foundational Christian doctrine. If you want to transform your marriage, meditate on God as your heavenly Father-in-law, who has opened up the banks of his riches and poured them out on us. Think of how much we owe our heavenly Father. One, we owe to him the fact that we're alive. He created us. And not just that he created us, but he made us humans. He could have made us squirrels. I know it seems funny, but he could have. How pathetic would that be? A day like today, in the cold and wind, running around, found a nut. Great day, great, I found a nut. Until you're running away and you get hit by a car and you're left on the roadside and your innards are pecked out by crows and nobody ever knows you live. But instead of making me a squirrel, instead of making you a squirrel, God said, be a human. You'll know what it is to see beauty. Listen to music. You'll know truth. You will laugh. We're the only creatures who laugh because we're the only creatures created in the image of God. Then he let us be husbands and wives and some of us parents and all that he gave us. And he said, this is what I've given you. And then for us here, Jesus Christ, his Holy Spirit, salvation, eternal life. I mean, we can't even begin to add up what we owe him. And so when my marriage becomes a way of worshiping my heavenly Father-in-law, now it's so different because I can look at my wife as his daughter. Look, I love my kids desperately, but I know they're not always going to be easy to love. I know what will most frustrate my two future sons-in-laws with each one of my daughters, what attitudes, what actions will be most difficult for them to deal with. Which is why if they would just let me pick, I think I could probably do a pretty good job for them. But I am praying that God will send someone to love them. Because it's scary to me how desperately I want my daughters to be loved as I want my son to be loved by his wife. And nothing makes me happier than when somebody loves one of my kids. The best way to show appreciation to me is to show appreciation to one of my kids. In fact, my youngest daughter was my favorite person this week because not only was she my daughter, but she did a great favor for my oldest daughter. So if you're one of my kids doing a favor for the other, I mean, you go right to the top, right? I mean, that, you know, if you're a parent, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Now imagine how your Heavenly Father and your Heavenly Father-in-law looks at it, that you take a son or a daughter who stumbles in many ways, James 3:2, who has their difficulties and their weaknesses, and yet you love them generously out of reverence for God. And this is what gives us the strength to go the distance in our marriage, because everything that the world celebrates, infatuation, neurologically, we know it fades 12 to 18 months. Beauty and vitality, look, we get older, not younger. All of those things that happen. But if I love my wife because, first and foremost, she's God's daughter to whom I owe everything. She could be an 85-year-old arthritic Alzheimer's patient, and she'll be no less worthy, no less God's daughter then than she is right now. And I will have every reason to keep loving her, and I want a lifelong love. And this is the truth that'll help me get there. It's the truth that'll help you get there. And if I could say a quick word to the singles here. This isn't just theory. Everything I've said is so key when you think about who you marry. Because if you are called to seek first the kingdom of God and you marry somebody who isn't a Christian, you're going to seek two different purposes. And it's going to tear you apart once the infatuation dies. And they're going to have a whole different view of what righteousness means. They're not going to seek the righteousness of Christ. They're going to seek the righteousness in their own heart. And you might even think that you have something that you're just going to have two entirely different aims. And 1 John 4:19 tells us we love because he first loved us. If you're not receiving God's love and you're not receiving God's grace, how are you going to pour out his love to others? And this last point about seeing marriage as worship and God as our Heavenly Father-in-law, I'll just be honest with you. 90% of the changes I've made in my marriage haven't been because my wife has confronted me. I mean, she's tried. I don't always listen. Most of the changes in my marriage have come because I go to God in prayer. And God says, Gary, I know you have all of these concerns in your heart, but before you get to one of those, I want to talk to you about how you're treating my daughter. And I'm not going to hear anything else until we get this right. And as a dad, I get it. That's what a dad would want to say to his son-in-law. And I just say to you single women, I'd say to you single men, what do you think works better? Conviction by the Holy Spirit or nagging? Ask any wife. There isn't a marriage in the history of the world that has been proved by nagging. You marry a man who worships God and serves God and listens to God and is convicted by God, you will be a much happier wife. Guys, you will be a much happier husband. It's not just theory. I'm not your dad. I'm not your mom. I just want you to have a fulfilled life. And I get excited when I see marriages that are joined around seeking first God's kingdom and righteousness, because it lifts two people up and they live for a purpose greater than themselves. And when two people are earnestly learning how to love, and we're in a world, and we've just seen it this last week, where there's so much hate being spewed all around. And here are people that are inspiring each other to learn how to love. And then they worship their Heavenly Father-in-law. So even when we're not worthy of being loved, out of reverence for a perfect God, we act in a way that is loving because our marriage is a part of worship. These are the things that give us a lifelong love. Let's pray. Father, it's all in your word. And I just pray now that your Spirit would cover us and seal this truth, that we would seek purpose if our marriages are floundering, where we could serve in this church. That we would seek righteousness, realizing what we're making our spouse put up with those little sins that we just don't confront. Well, that we would understand our greatest need so we wouldn't resent the trials of marriage, but could even appreciate their necessary place. But even more, Lord, that we would see that loving our spouse is a way of loving you. What you've given us, who we married, not an orphan, but your very son or daughter. Help us to love them as you have loved us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand together. Thankful again that you're here today, and if, again, you're a guest and you have a few minutes, we'd love to see you over at Guest Central. Next Sunday's Impact Sunday, and we did this last year for the first time, so this will be the second year we do Impact Sunday, and I cannot wait to tell you stuff I've been wanting to tell you for about 60 days. You will not believe what happened in this church and through this church the last 60 days. And so we're going to celebrate next week, so bring your dancing shoes, and the question we're going to pose next week is one that God incarnate posed to us. Jesus, when he looked at Peter and he said, and he's going to look at us and he's going to ask us the same thing, do you love me? It's going to be a great Sunday. So it's been a great one today. I hope you'll stop by the book table and pick up a book. There may be someone you know that could use one as well, so buy two or three. And I've already decided I've got some friends I'm going to give them to this week. I got eight friends I'm going to give them to. I'm one of the eight, so I've got seven friends, but we're going to read it together and do our job. So, Gary, thanks so much for being here. That was just, what a phenomenal weekend it's been. So we're so thankful. Let's pray and give God thanks. Father, thank you for this time we've had together. Thank you, Father, for the privilege, the freedom to be in this place, to worship, to focus on what really matters. And today, Father, we thank you that we have heard from you. We've worshiped you, we've spoken to you, and now we leave just praising you all the more in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a great Sunday.